Good morning. Kind of a change of scenery, wouldn't you say? It was 20 degrees today, and as much as I would love to be outside, I couldn't do it. I couldn't. I can't. I won't. I won't. I washed my coat and my gloves and everything yesterday, and I put them all in the dryer. Well, when they came out, I'm giving you an excuse here. It's the best I can come up with. But when they came out, my gloves weren't dry on the hello. Weren't dry. Speaking of things that weren't dry, my gloves weren't dry on the inside, so I can't go out there because if I put on wet gloves, they're just gonna freeze my hands, and I can't see using up all that propane to run my gas-powered dryer just to dry a pair of gloves. So I'm just gonna have to wait. And my little crackhead came in to visit me. Let me shut the door so cold air doesn't come in. Hey, little R. How you doing? Yeah, you wondered where I was, didn't you? Okay, you wait right here. Hey, how you doing? You little butt wagger, you. He smells good. Yes, he does. He smells really good. And the reason he smells so good is because he smelled so bad. Yeah, we are going out for a walk. We go for a daily walk. Mike and the dogs and I, we go out and we walk the property twice a day to get our cardio and get a little bit of exercise because we're kind of cooped up in the winter. So we take the dogs outside. Well, deer come through our yard quite a bit, and the deer like to poop as they walk. And little R and Tiki, not Tanner. Tanner doesn't roll. He doesn't roll like that. So Tiki and Rascal, whenever they smell something really, really bad, they just feel the need to roll in it. And Rascal got a big old smear of poop all over his neck and back, and I didn't know this. No, we came in for our walk, and Tiki and Tanner are in their bed, and I'm kneeling down, and I'm just kind of nuzzling them, and I do that a lot. And Rascal gets up on the ottoman right next to him by the couch. I decide to give him his share of attention, so I rub my face on him, and yeah, it happened. I got it on my head, and I stunk, and he stunk, and he couldn't figure out why I was so crazy, not upset, but just so grossed out because the smell made me want to throw up. So here I am running to wash myself up because there's not enough soap to make me not want to throw up. As soon as I'm done, I went after him. He's hiding underneath Mike's desk by Mike's feet, like, no. So I had to pick him up, put him in the kitchen sink, and give him a bath. Thing is that he doesn't think he likes baths, just like any kid. But once you get him in there and you get the Mr. Bubble going, he loves it. Once I get the warm water on him, he's like, oh, Daddy, don't let it in. So yeah, he smells really good. He smells like shampoo right now. Okay, that had nothing to do with today's program, but I just like to talk. You know, there was a person, I don't remember the name. I don't remember names, and especially if this one is probably good that I don't. Last weekend edition, I get good comments mostly, like 99.999%, but there's always that one who has to come in and try and pee in our punch bowl. Somebody posted a comment that I found kind of odd. It wasn't even offensive. It was just, I got to use the word stupid. Yeah, I don't use that word very often anymore, but I had to use the word stupid on this one. He posted, you never answer questions, unsubscribing. And I just sat there. I turned around to Mike. I said, this is what he said. And Mike laughed, and I laughed, and the computer laughed. But he actually posted on Weekend Edition that I don't answer questions. And I'm thinking, did you even watch the video? That's all I did in this video was answer questions. So yeah, there's no pleasing some people. They just don't want to be pleased. Anyway, it is Weekend Edition. Welcome to Weekend Edition, where I answer your questions on anything you have to ask about, mostly gardening, but other things, cooking, life, dogs, cats, the sun, anything that you have questions on, I give you answers because that's what I do here. I answer your questions as well as I possibly can. And I want to urge you, if you do have a question, an honest question, there are no such thing as stupid questions. Some people say, I'm sorry, this is a dumb question. No, bad dog. There is no such thing as a stupid question. If you need an answer, you should ask. And don't ever be afraid to ask it, especially here. Other places, I can't say for what they're going to do, but here, there's no such thing as a stupid question. So ask away. I got some questions from you, so let's get right to it, okay? First one, Charlie. Good morning, Charlie. Ray, in the background, in between the two sets of double trees, is that a tank? I had to put that one on first because I sat there and I thought, what is he talking about? So I had actually played last week's Weekend Edition, and that's where I sat by the trunk. the tree. Remember, I sat by the tree. I think that was last week, so the week before. Anyway, I was sitting by a tree, and no, in the background, the only thing I could think of is you were seeing farm machinery. Way back on that side of the property, that's the west side of the property, that's where all that junk is being dumped by my lovely neighbor. And one of them is a piece of farm machinery that he uses to spray chemicals. Yeah, and it has a piece that aims up. I think that's what you're talking about, maybe a tank? No. You know, it'd be kind of cool if I had a tank next to my property. I could do a weekend edition sitting on a tank, the military edition. No, but that's no tank. I think that's all you're talking about, unless you meant like a propane tank? I don't know. Anyway, Peter. Morning, Peter. Hello, Ray. A new subscriber here. I love the new subscribers. I love all my subscribers, but the new ones, whenever I get a new one, I like that because it's like walking into a candy store. They see a program, they see another program, they're loving this, they're loving that. They haven't gotten used to all of this yet. So they're really brand shiny new, and they got that look of wonder in their eyes, and that really gets me charged up. Anyway, new subscriber here. I am curious that in your video that you mentioned the large elm tree that you had cut down to protect your house, which is understandable, was the elm tree diseased at all before you had to cut the tree down? Yes. Yes, I had an expert come in and check the tree out to see if everything was okay, because I was telling my concerns about it falling on my house. I even spoke to my insurance company. And so I brought in an expert. He checked it out, and he said that there was rot in the center of the tree. And he didn't guarantee that that would cause the tree to fall, but he said that it could spread. And that could cause some weakening of the tree. And with such a large tree and the winds that we have here, you never know what's going to happen. I just couldn't take that risk. So that's why I cut the tree back. But as you saw, and I think it was the last episode, it's growing back. You can't keep a good tree down. So I didn't kill it. I just kind of really, really did the most pruning I've ever done on a plant. And hopefully it'll turn out okay. Next one, Name Namison. I'm not making this up. That's the name. Name Namison. I live in an apartment with limited space, and I grow tomatoes in containers on the balcony. How would you recommend I grow them, prune them, etc.? Well, that's a kind of wide-ranging question, but I'm going to try and break it down. Break it down. Hammer time. But as far as doing them in containers, if they're on your balcony, keep them in the brightest spot possible. Keep them from vining too awful much. First of all, I would suggest if you're going to grow tomatoes in a pot on a balcony and you don't have a lot of space, and I'm assuming you don't if you have a balcony, determinate tomatoes are one of your better buys, or a smaller variety. Determinate as opposed to indeterminate. Indeterminate will grow and grow and grow until the earth ends. They will never stop growing, all right, until frost kills them, or you kill them, or you just get tired of them, or they go off to college. Whereas a determinate one generally will grow so far, put out all its produce, and then it's done. Those ones tend to be a little bit more compact because they're grown for production. That's what production tomatoes are, the ones you get at the store. They're not grown on indeterminate vines, because there would be all kinds of unripe ones, half-ripe ones that they're harvesting. They want tomatoes that are going to grow up, put out all their fruit, then they yank the plant out, harvest the tomatoes, and then they're done with it. That's a determinate variety. I would recommend one of those, and also you can prune it back selectively and just have a couple branches coming off. You don't have to have a ton of tomatoes, and I wouldn't recommend it on a balcony garden unless you have a huge pot and a lot of sun. You can do that and train them up a trellis, but if you have limited space, no. Prune them back selectively, have a few tomatoes, be happy with that, and then once it's done, you can prune the whole plant back if you have more growing season and grow it again. Or you can take a cutting and start it off in a new pot and start all over again. That's how I would do it. Keep it very well fertilized. Why am I doing that? Keep it very well fertilized because in a pot, there's limited nutrients. And tomatoes, they suck it up. They will suck the nutrients right out of that soil and leave a barren, arid wasteland. So make sure that you have good compost, or you feed it mildly, constantly, so that it'll always have something to feed it. That's one of the key points. Next one, Karen. I really like the big yellow sweet peppers. Everybody does. Those are great. I love the big yellow sweet peppers. They're pricey to buy. How do you grow those? Do you bury green? Do you buy green pepper plants and wait for them to turn yellow, or are there specific yellow pepper plants? Well, Karen, there's both. There are pepper plants that will put out yellow peppers, but I won't say most because then somebody's going to come across with, no, there's a lot of these. Many of them, like say bell peppers, bell peppers start out green, you know, they're the common pepper. They start out green, you let them ripen, they'll turn a little bit yellow, orangish, and then red, the most beautiful red. And the reason they turn colors is the sugars are condensing and the flavors are solidifying in the pepper. Where you pick a green one, it's good, but it tastes like a green pepper. Whereas if you wait for it to turn all the way yellow or red, it's at its sweetest and it has the most depth of pepper flavor. Jalapenos, they start out green. Sometimes they'll turn a purplish color with stripes on them. Then they turn red. When they're red, they have a more fulfilling pepper flavor. Marconis, they start out like that. Banana peppers, they'll do that. They start out a beautiful light green. They turn orange and then they turn red. So bell peppers, banana peppers, Hungarian wax peppers, a lot of peppers will start out green and turn red in the end. And in between, there's yellow. So there are yellow bell peppers. If you want to grow those, you can grow yellow peppers. Look online and just look for yellow peppers and find out if they're yellow all the way through. I can't give you a list of all of them, but yeah, you can grow green peppers generally and they will turn yellow, but I would wait until they turn red. They're going to be, or orange. They're going to taste the best then. Next one, Kite Springer. Hey, Kite. I would love to hear your thoughts about cherry trees. Well, I'd love to hear my thoughts too. Sweet cherries can be tough to grow in my region, but it can definitely be done. I have two 5-year-old trees that were doing well until this year when one of them started seeping sap and losing branches. Oh, I've heard of that one. I don't know if it will survive the winter. When I tried to get an arborist to visit for help, they told me over the phone that, quote, it has rot and to give it up, you should have planted pear trees. End of quote. Boy, I don't know who that arborist is, but they probably shouldn't be in business. Anyway, he continues, do you have any experience with conditions like this? There are very limited options for fungicides available in Canada. Well, in Canada, in any place actually, when you have weeping, which is basically what he's talking about, is sap that comes out of the trees. My peach trees had this. One of my peach trees had sap that comes out of it. It can be for any number of reasons. Generally, it's either physical damage, or it's a fungus damage, or it's a disease. You don't know until you actually examine it. It's just like a person, you know? Oh, my shoulder hurts here. Well, it's bursitis. Well, you don't know. Do some tests. It could be arthritis. It could just be a ligament damage. You don't know until you check it out. An arborist, of all people, is basically somebody who knows about a plant doctor. And an arborist should actually examine the subject before they pronounce any kind of judgment on, and to tell you, oh, you should just grow pear trees. That's wrong, okay? I'm just going to say it, that's wrong. If an arborist came out and said, just told me over the phone, I just hang up on him and I call somebody who's actually qualified. Now, I'm no expert, I'm no arborist, but I've had trees that actually had this happen. What I did was, I left them alone. Because I know of no way to stop this. You can take off the sap, and, you know, take it off, cut it off with a knife and wipe it off, keep it as clean as possible to keep any kind of disease or insects from coming in and causing any kind of damage. That's one thing you can do. You can also, any part where it's seeping out, maybe wrap it, not too awful tight, but with an ACE bandage around there or gauze, and then seal it. What that will do is it'll keep it out of the air a little bit, and animals and insects won't attack it. That will not stop it from seeping, but what can help it is time. I know this sounds really simplistic, but it worked for me. One of my peach trees was oozing sap 2 years ago. And I thought, wow, that's kind of inconvenient. And what I did was I just ignored it. What I did, I also did was I fertilized it with some compost. I put a nice heavy ring of compost. I made sure I gave it deep watering, let it dry, deep watering, let it dry. I did selective pruning to get some of the crossover branches and inner branches out. What that did is it caused the strongest of branches to grow faster, stronger, thicker. And that's what the compost did. That's what the selective pruning did. And that's also what the deep watering did. The deep watering got the roots to grow down deeper. What I did in practice was I made the tree stronger. I couldn't cure the disease, but what I could do is I could support the tree to help it hopefully outgrow this disease, because they can outgrow it. Sometimes they can outgrow it and it'll just stop. A young tree is more susceptible to this than older trees. As the tree gets older, it gets stronger. It puts out tissue around an area that's wounded, and it'll bypass it. I've had trees that broke and fell over, but they didn't snap all the way, and they put out tissue around it. One of my mulberry trees did that. And it continued growing, and I still get mulberries to this day. It may not be the prettiest thing in the world. It's not perfect, but it's the best that you can do. Sometimes things happen with our plants. We can't cure them all, but we can give them the best supportive care that we can. And as if I were an arborist, that's what I would have given you advice on. Try to support the tree. You may not be able to save it, but you may be able to save it. Don't give up. Don't give up. If you have a really bad branch and it's not necessary and it's oozing really bad and it's losing stuff, cut it off. Try and promote the healthier stuff that may not be sick. That's my advice to you. That's my best advice, and I wish you luck on your tree. Next one, L. Palfi. I think I've had a question from L. Palfi, but I got another one. And I don't mind repeat questions. If you have repeat questions, go for it. If you have more questions and you've already been on the program, post your questions. I don't mind at all. L. Palfi. How can I get my small apple tree to produce apples? When I got it, it had about 6 apples. I tried to hand pollinate, but it just wouldn't grow any more apples. It's now 6 feet high on its 3rd year. It didn't produce flowers. What am I doing wrong? Oh, that's an easy one to answer. You're doing absolutely nothing wrong. Young trees, especially like apples. Now, there are exceptions, but I'm going to talk in general. Generally, apple trees, from the time you plant them as young trees, give them 6 to maybe 7, 8 years to start producing. The fact that you got apples already is a bonus. And not all fruit trees will produce every single year. Sometimes they go in cycles. If they're really filled with energy in their stems and their roots from the winter in the previous season, they had a good production year to get that energy saved up for the winter. They're going to have extra energy to start out in the spring. They'll put out blossoms. The pollinators come out. If you don't get a late cold spell, see, cold spells when the blossoms are out can kill the blossoms. Even though the blossoms don't fall off, it harms the blossoms. It also harms the pollinators and keeps them from coming out. And also, some of them need a cross pollinator. So I don't know if your apple tree needs a cross pollinator. Maybe when you got it at the nursery, it was near a cross pollinator. That's why it got apples. So I don't know what type of apple tree you have, so I really can't speak to that. But if you want to make sure that your tree produces better, if you have room, get a crab apple tree. Or a tree, look up your tree type and find out what's a good cross pollinator for it. Plant that tree about 20 feet away, and you have a better pollinating success. Also, like I mentioned earlier, I'll go back to this. Not all trees produce every single year. One year they'll produce, the next year they'll produce, the next year, nothing. My trees have done that. I have a mature tree that did that. It's kind of inconvenient and it sucks, but it's not your fault. That's just how things work. And also give it time. Feed your plant. Remember the last question I talked about supporting your plant? Do that. And make sure that you support your plant, give it the best possible foundation it can, and in time, it's going to give you fruit. It's going to happen, all right? All right, I need to reset my camera and start on page 2 with your questions.
Hey. Oh, that feels good.
You smell good. Every time I scratch him, I smell shampoo, so I've been scratching him extra. Okay, let's get on with this, shall we? Mike. Hey, Mike. Ray. Would you ever grow a little bonsai tree indoors? Well, I'm just going to give it to you honest. I don't much care for bonsai. It's not my style. I like to promote, this is just for me, okay? I'm not putting down bonsai. It's an exquisite, intricate art. And it's an art, not just a practice. You have to really focus on your plants. It's a Zen type of thing. And you got to know this and you move that. It's a dance between plant and human, and it's actually absolutely beautiful to watch. But that's not me. I'm not a dancer. I promote the most plant I possibly can, and I do experiment with plants, with pruning and stuff, but I just don't like the idea of me growing a plant that's so limited and stunted, you know? It's just not for me. So no, I would never grow a bonsai plant, purposely. I may have one that looks like one, but it's not from actual being me doing it on purpose, no. David, hey David. Have you ever thought of growing your own grains and making your own chicken feed? Yes, and I did do that one year. When I lived on the 80 acres, before I had 80 acres, I had 40 acres. And the house that I built up front, well, I planted this area of grains. I grew barley, wheat, and millet. I think it was sorghum. And I plowed up an area, I put up a fence, I tried to grow all of this, and the wild critters there just ate it all up. It was the worst failure, the biggest failure I've ever had. Now, grains for me are very inexpensive to buy. In order for me to feed my flock, I would have to devote so much land to growing all of that. It would be over an acre, maybe 2 acres, to grow that volume of grain. And I have to grow all different kinds, sunflower seeds, sorghum, corn, because the goats and the chickens require a variety. They can't just survive on that. Now, that undertaking would require me to plow up areas. I can't plow. I don't have a plow. I don't have a tractor. I don't have a rototiller. So I don't have the equipment to actually do that. And in addition, I don't believe, it's just not something that I want to do. I don't want to grow it. Don't want to have to deal with harvesting it. That's a lot of work for me. And I like to just relax on my time off. And I have, as I do more and more around here with the animals, the Voodoo Garden, the Praxis Channel, trying to keep my pets satisfied and to have a little spare time for myself, that would take a lot of my time and energy. And it's just not for me. Some people do that. There are gardening channels where they grow all their own stuff and they feed their animals naturally off the land, and that is fantastic. More power to them. I think it's a great thing, but it's just not me. No, I just as soon buy my grain, feed the animals, feed them scraps, and that keeps us all happy, and it also gives me more spare time. Next one, Alan. Alan has... Stupid fungus gnats. One of these days, they're going to be dead. Yeah, we got fungus gnats. And it's not from my compost or my soil. They came in from outside and they found my Voodoo Garden. See, outside insects will find the inside. And they decided to set up shop. So eventually I'm going to have to get those yellow sticky traps and spray my soil with neem or get some more of those predatory mites, one of the two. But they're not bothering. See, that's the thing. With fungus gnats, they generally don't bother healthy growing plants. It's usually young seedlings that we're starting, and they're also just a nuisance. You know, they're flying in your face and stuff, but they don't really do a heck of a lot of damage to healthy plants. Some folks, they might say different, but my plants are surviving just fine, and I don't do anything special for them. Alan says, oh, by the way, hey, Alan. He says, what breed is Tiny R? Well, hey, Tiny R. Want to come over for this one? Come on. Come on, show off. You're beautiful, and you smell good. This is Tiny R. This is my best buddy, for those of you who don't know. He's a little critter. Hear that sound? That's his happy sound. Yeah, it's like a dog purring. Little R I found on a road. He found me on a dirt road, and I adopted him as my friend. Not a pet. I don't own him. I'm not his master. He's my best buddy. And we coexist beautifully. I'm his caretaker. I protect him. I watch out for him. I love him. And he does the same for me. So it's a two-way street. We both take care of each other. And I think that's how it should be between companions. They're not property. They're not showpieces or anything. I don't think of them as that. So we live together. We eat together. We sleep together. We run around together. We're like peas and carrots. We are. Little R is, he knows his name. He's either called Little R, Rascal, Tiny R, Crackhead, and people have asked me, why do you call him Crackhead? Well, no offense to anybody who's addicted to crack. I don't mean to offend you, but from what I see on police programs that I watch and also other programs, people that are addicted to crack tend to be jittery and move around a lot and have a little control over their movements. It's just one of the side effects of the drug. It's a horrible, horrible thing that it does to people, and I feel bad for them. And little R doesn't like to hold still. He's running around. He's nibbling on my ankle. He's biting my hand. He's licking my face. He's making sure everything. See, got to make sure the tip of that finger's good. Yep. He's always taking care of things, making sure the dogs are in line. The chickens know who's boss. He's running around doing all this. He's frenetic is what he is. And that means he's just jittery, running around. And little dogs are sometimes like that. So I call him Crackhead. It's a term of endearment. But Crackhead is little R is a Norfolk Terrier, very similar to Norwich Terriers. But Norwich Terriers have short ears that stand up all the time. Norfolk Terriers have the ear that flops down, although he can stick them straight up when he wants, or one or two, and do them like periscopes. He's a Norfolk Terrier, purebred, I believe. I got him in 2010. Don't know his age. but he was thinner, and he looked younger, and he didn't have as much gray on his face. So I'm assuming he was maybe 1 to 2 years old at the time. So that was 2010. So he's about maybe 9 to 10 years old now. Yep, he's still got many, many good years ahead of him, and he's my best buddy. I just can't imagine not having him around. Karen, didn't I just answer a question from? Yeah, probably a different Karen. I got a whole fleet of Karens here. Hey, Karen too. Karen says, Ray, does your lawn get the same benefit from leaves whether you mow them or let them compost over the winter or burn them and sprinkle the ashes over the grass? Well, I don't do that. I don't fertilize my lawn at all. I just let nature take care of it, for one thing. But for lawns in general, the benefits that you're going to get from whether it's leaves or burnt leaves are a little bit different. Leaves have a lot of minerals. That's where they're good for your lawn. Okay, the trees put their roots way down where grass can't get or other plants can't get. They drop the minerals, they go into the leaves fall, the leaves break down, and they give your lawn and other plants on your ground the minerals, the benefit of the minerals that were brought up by the trees. That's their benefit, okay? Now, when you burn the leaves, and also leaves that decompose, generally tend to be about even in pH. Some people say they're acidic, some people say they're not. I say they're about average, okay? Because as the moisture leaves them, so does the nitrogen, any nitrogen that was left behind. They give the carbon to the soil and the minerals to the soil. Now, in a nutshell, okay, I am no botanist, but in a nutshell, this is what it is. The leaves have, I believe it's called potassium sulfate or carbonate, one or both, okay? That is going to be on the alkaline side. They also have sulfur in them, which is on the acidic side. These balance each other out. These are just two of the many minerals that are in the leaves. Now, when you burn the leaves, the sulfur goes up. Okay, certain things are taken away in the smoke. Smoke is an item, okay, and it is taken from the leaves. That is an indication that something is leaving what's being burned, okay? Sulfur is one of the things that leaves. So that takes away the acidity part, and it makes your ashes alkaline. That's why ashes are alkaline, which is way up on the pH scale, whereas acidity is way down below. So you're disturbing the balance of that. That being said, you can spread ashes on your lawn or on your garden, just a light covering, and then till them in. That's perfectly fine because it's not enough to change it. And also, when you're making compost, you can mix ashes in moderate quantities. I mean, don't go dumping everything into your compost pile because compost tends to have a little bit of acidity in it as it decomposes, and the ashes can help out as well. With the minerals, it's going to balance out your compost. But the ashes and also the leaves, they have a high calcium content. It's a wonderful thing. Calcium is great for your soil. The only problem is, here's the problem. When you burn your leaves, you have the calcium, but you have alkaline. So when you're going to use that to add, I mean, it's like 20% or some crazy amount of calcium in those leaves. You might think, oh, that's great. Calcium's good for plants. It helps get rid of blossom end rot. Well, when you add the ashes into your garden, I'm just talking your garden, not your lawn, but even your garden, what that's going to do is raise the pH to an alkaline level, which means your plants are less able to use the calcium that's available in the soil. My advice when people have blossom end rot or a stunted growth, that's a calcium deficiency. I tell them to make the soil more acidic by adding sulfur. So if you take it down, it can use that calcium that's already in the soil and you don't have to add it. So even though the ashes have a lot of calcium, it makes it so that your soil is plants in your soil are unable to use it as effectively as they normally will. If you want to use ashes, spread a little bit of sulfur on there as well. How much? I don't know because I don't know how many ashes you're using. But in a nutshell, use it in moderation, okay? You can crush up your leaves, spread them on there, mow them up with your mower and grind them all up if you want. Composting them is the best way to use them, but if you don't want to do that, just mow over them a whole bunch of times and grind them all up and leave them on your soil. There really is no need to burn the leaves. It pollutes the air, it lets all kinds of crap into the environment, and it really is not necessary. Okay, we got one from Pushkar. Oh, he's in Minneapolis. Hey, a fellow Minnesotaite. Anyway, a Minnesotan. Pushkar says, hey, hi, Ray. I'm starting a new garden next spring in Minneapolis. I would appreciate your suggestions on one fruit tree and one non-fruit tree for my backyard. If I just plant one fruit tree, will it self-pollinate or do I need at least a pair? Very good question. Well, it depends on the type of fruit tree. There is no answer for all of them. But I'm going to go with, if you want to plant one fruit tree, if it were me, if I had one fruit tree to plant, it would be apples. Apples are versatile, they're delicious, they're sweet, and the flowers have a great smell. It's an all across win for me, as far as I'm concerned, because I like the smell, I like the look, I like the taste of apples. You can make apple sauce, apple juice, apple cider, apple wine. You can dehydrate them and have apple chips, natural candy in the wintertime. It's a wonderful thing. So if you were going to go with just an apple tree, I wrote down a few suggestions for you. Actually, of different fruit trees, okay? If you're going to go with an apple tree, I would say Golden Delicious. Golden Delicious is good because it's a very sweet apple that will grow in your zone. I believe you're in zone 4A, 3B, something like that. Yeah, it'll grow in your zone beautifully. Now, if you want to get a pollinator for it, you can plant a crab apple tree, but Golden Delicious will self-pollinate. There are going to be people who say they don't. Well, they do. And I actually picked apples in Washington, and we picked Golden Delicious. And there were only Golden Delicious in that area. There weren't pollinators for those, so they're pollinating themselves. They will. Most apple trees will grow, put out more fruit if they have cross-pollinators, but most of them will put out apples if they don't have a pollinator. Some of them won't. The Golden Delicious is a good one to grow. They're a beautiful tree, beautiful fruit, and they're one of the best producing, best tasting apples. If you're going to go plum, a Methley, put it right here, Methley plum. And I'm growing one of those. That's my plum tree that's growing really big and beautiful. That's a Methley plum. Delicious fruit. You can make prunes out of them. You can make plum jelly, plum jam, all kinds of good stuff, seasonings for stuff. It's a beautiful tree. That one will grow perfectly in your area. A pear tree. I've grown this as well. I've grown two different kinds of pears, but an Anjo pear. Anjo. I'll put these right here so you can see them. Anybody else that wants to grow these in cooler climates, Anjo pear is a wonderful one to grow in a cooler climate. They will self-pollinate and they put out delicious, delicious fruit. And the last one is North Star cherry. I had one of those as well in Minnesota. I had a lot of fruit trees. I'm a big fan of fruit because it's delicious. I can pick it right off the tree, and I've always loved fruit trees. For some reason, I've just always loved them. I figure if I'm gonna have a tree, it might as well feed me while it's feeding the pollinators and looking good too. And a North Star cherry will put out the sour, they're called sour cherries, but they're really not. When they get fully ripe, they're delicious. Those are the red cherries you make pies out of. And they're beautiful. The birds love them, so make sure that you don't just leave them on the tree. When they get ripe, pull them off. And also, if you have kids love cherries. I loved them as a kid. They're absolutely delicious. Okay, those are the fruit trees for you. Now, if you're going to go with a non-fruit tree as well, my suggestion, just my personal preference, would be a maple. Either a sugar maple or a red maple. Those two are absolutely beautiful. Sunset maples are beautiful as well. Minnesota is the area for maples. Those kinds of maple trees are going to put out the most beautiful trees, nice shapes, not too awful huge, not too awful small, beautiful leaves, and in the autumn, it's a shocking, beautiful color that is going to accentuate your yard. And when the leaves fall, of course, you can use the leaves for compost, and because they break down beautifully, but also it goes really beautifully on a carpet. When they fall down there, you have such a shock of colors in your lawn. It's a great tree, and I definitely recommend that. Next one, Christopher. Hey, Christopher. Hi, buddy. Do you think it'll work to start asparagus indoors from seeds now and plant out when the spring comes, or will they just get very confused? Well, Christopher, no. Your plants will not get confused. And if they do, who cares? My plants, they get a little confused every now and then, but I'm a little confused and it all works out well. No, you can start your asparagus indoors. If you get asparagus seeds, start them. My suggestion would be to start them in January. For an average area like this, okay? I don't know if you're in Texas or wherever, but start them about maybe 4 months before spring. Oops, Rascal wants out. Hold on a second.
Yeah.
You get bored with daddy, don't you? Okay. Go. Spread joy. Be a good citizen. Ah, kids. They love you 1 minute and then they need to just run off the next. Okay, back to the asparagus. I grew asparagus in the voodoo garden. I don't know where the video is, but if I find the link, I'll post it below. Okay? And I planted the seeds. I gathered them off my plants. I planted the seeds, grew them indoors. They grew up inside, and I had to keep putting them into larger pots because asparagus put out roots like mad. And one of the things you want to make sure is, if you're going to grow asparagus inside, start them in a pot that's at least 6 inches. Okay, that way it gives them room to put out their roots. You don't want a huge mass of choking roots because asparagus are known for their roots that spread out far and wide. That's what they do out in the garden. So you want to make sure you give them a decent sized pot. Don't put them in a little pot thinking, oh, that'll be nice, because then the roots get all tangled up and it gives them a little bit of a delay when you put them out in the garden. So give them a decent sized pot. Don't plant a whole bunch of them together. Plant one per pot. Okay, you'll thank me later on that when I found out. So you plant them inside, give them the brightest light you possibly can, and if they get a little bit too tall and lanky, cut them back halfway. It's okay. They'll put out another plant from the bottom and they'll start growing in clusters. So by the time you plant them in spring, you'll have a little cluster of asparagus plants. Plant them, give them about maybe 2 years to grow outside without harvesting, then you can start harvesting your plants. But when you plant them outside, be sure, I don't know if you know this, but I'm gonna let you know, put a lot of compost in with that soil because you got one chance to do it right. And you see that little fungus net? These are buzzing your nose. Okay, sorry about that. Give them a lot of rich soil when they're inside and when they're outside. Asparagus need that to grow. Last one, and I saved this for last. This is from Kiki D. Does anybody know that name, Kiki D? Well, I'm sure she put it because of Elton John. Yeah, Elton John did a song with Kiki D called Don't Go Breaking My Heart. Yeah, that's where I'm assuming she got the name. So I always thought that was a cool name. I've seen her comment before, but this is the first time I think she's given me a question. Hey, Kiki. Ray, what are some of the most memorable favorite gifts given to you by subscribers? Have you ever received anything deeply moving? Now, that's the final question of the day. And that one, I'm going to take a little bit of time, but I'm going to make sure that I answer that precisely. Yes. First of all, every gift I get is special to me. And I'm not just saying that. Because for me, a person, those of you who followed along with my reading of my life in my book, I didn't used to be an open person. I was a very closed person. I kept to myself. I walked my path kind of as a loner. And I didn't open up about myself, didn't tell much about myself, didn't get involved with people that much. And so for me to open up to people was something a whole different ballgame. And I started slowly. It was kind of painful, kind of jittery on my first programs. But then slowly I started doing it more and more. And now I'm the comfortable person that I am today. But what I did notice is that people would connect with me. You. Would connect with me and you would just feel I keep using the word connection, but that's what it is, that I'm a real person and that I make you feel like you're a real person and not just somebody at the other end of this camera. And I don't try to do that. That's just how it is, because I've actually learned how to connect with people. And this is the medium that I use. I use YouTube to do this and Facebook. And I've met some people in real life. It was incredible. But when people feel a connection, they want to share themselves. I've heard so many stories, so many comments, so many things from people of their personal life. And I've gotten to know so many people. It's like a family for me. Now, this family, every now and then, they want to send me something. Some people ask, some people don't ask. It doesn't matter to me. But the fact is they took the time and they had the thought that they want to share something with me. And that meant something to me, regardless of what they sent. They sent drawings from their children, and they sent drawings from themselves. I have so much artwork that was sent to me by viewers. Gifts, personal, store-bought, monetary, written, drawn, you name it, home-baked, you name it, it has arrived to me, and it numbers in the hundreds throughout the years. I can't even count. I couldn't even begin to count all the things that I've received from people, plants, seeds, you name it. It has arrived at my house, and every single one is special to me in that way, in the fact that people took the time and the energy and the money and the thought to do this for me. I am overwhelmed. And some of them were just so caught up in what I was doing here. Like, for instance, when I adopted Tiki and Tanner, and also when Rascal went through his Lyme disease scare, and I had to clear out my savings account in order to help him out. And the nice thing about that is he's no longer having seizures. So, you know, it was money well spent. And Tiki and Tanner, money well spent. You know, they're having a better life, and I would do it all over again in a heartbeat if I had the opportunity. And someday I'll probably have the opportunity with more dogs. But for right now, when I announced them, people reached out to me, and they sent well wishes. They sent gifts, and some of the gifts were quite extravagant. And not extravagant as in a waste. Extravagant as in, wow, it blew my mind. I received dog food in the mail, and cash donations to purchase things like medical care, more dog food, collars, clothes, whatever they needed, it is taken care of by my friends. And that, for me, is it's incredible. I use that word precisely, incredible. One person sent two boxes of the largest bags of Science Diet, the type that I use. I was buying these little bags, and I got these two big boxes in the mail of because somebody asked, Ray, could you use some dog food? And I said, well, yeah, if you have some dog food, I wouldn't mind. I use only this type of dog food because it's small nuggets and it's good for them. So she sent giant bags. And I thought, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? And the dogs loved it. They were walking all over the bags, and I set them aside. And I thought, well, this is a lifetime of dog food. Thank you so much. And then another person sent me three giant bags of a different type of dog food. And this stuff, it is very premium dog food that I could never afford on my own. I've never even heard of it. And it was called Imogen? I don't know. I'll put the name right here. They sent that. And I'm still feeding the dogs with that a year later. Yeah, I had so much dog food, I didn't know what to do with it. And I was feeding some of it to Big Head, of course, and these little dogs love it. I mean, they absolutely love it. They don't spit it out and go, ooh, this is subpar. They are appreciating your gift every single day. And so I appreciate that, because it's people who thought of something that I care dearly about, they thought to help me with that. And that blows my mind that people will do that for another person. It doesn't surprise me. It's just I'm overwhelmed when I'm actually the recipient, and I'm buried in love and kindness from people. Now, that being said, there have been other things that I hang up on the wall, some things I don't hang up on the wall. Some things are never mentioned. Some things are very personal. And some people don't want to be mentioned. Some people do want to be mentioned. But there is one that, two things that I want to bring to you, and I got to run upstairs and get them, because I keep them by my desk so that I look at them every single day. Not that every gift isn't precious, but these two are from people that I am very close to, and I want to make sure that they know that something is very precious. Okay, so hold on, grab a cup of coffee, and I'll meet you right back here. It rattles around in this little plastic container. This is different. This is something that is worth, I don't know, a penny to some people. And if I were to die today and they auctioned off everything I had, and, you know, to get rid of all my stuff, this would be on the auction table, and people would look at it and go, why did they even put this here? It's not worth anything. And they throw it in the trash. Value is in the eye and the heart of the beholder. This little plastic container, I want to show you up close, because it's something that I want you to see. Pinto beans. Yep. It says pinto bean, 85 days, 2018. Pinto beans. Now when I wake up in the morning and have my coffee, this is on my desk, on the shelf right in front, on top of my monitor, and I always see it when I turn on the light. This was given to me by a friend named Nancy. She's been my friend for forever, basically, and she's a supporter of everything that I do here. She writes me a letter once a month, and she helps me. She helps me. Sometimes I just need to hear a nice voice, because sometimes YouTube can be a little bit of a drain, and you get crazy people, and you have the trolls, and you're having a bad day and stuff. And she writes letters and tells me about her life. And then Mike, who loves to get mail, he loves getting mail, but of course he doesn't have a lot of friends, so he doesn't get a lot of mail. So what happens is the mail that I get, he reads to me because my eyes aren't as great as they used to be. And he reads people's writing so much better than me, and he loves opening up mail. So Mike gets the mail. And he reads Nancy's letters to me, and she tells me a little bit about her life, her children, her world, the things that are going on in her life. And it's just my window, a monthly window into somebody else's life. She sent me this because those of you who followed along in my life's journey, you know that the first plant I ever grew was a pinto bean, and I stole it from my mom's cupboard. And it was a precious moment in my life that actually put me on the path of what I do now and the person that I am today. So a pinto bean is something very special to me. I always have a bag of them upstairs, and I always have pinto beans available. I eat pinto beans quite a bit. I use them in a lot of my cooking. And she sent me these. These will never be eaten. These will never be grown. Maybe one day I'll grow one of them. But they're something that's very special to me, and she knew that this was something that was very special to me, and she thought of that. So that is something that I think of every single day of people who reach out, and they want to make sure that you understand that they understand. And this one here is something that I've never shown you before, and I want to take this up front and show you. Okay, because this is something that I value very highly. This is a piece of artwork on a little easel. It's a little painting with writing from a friend. And look who it is. That's little R. Yes, a friend of mine painted this. Hand-painted, didn't draw over it or anything. She was a bit of an artist, and she decided to make this for me. And it's not so much the product, but the story that I think you're going to enjoy. Her name was Audra. Audra Brown. In, I think, 2012 or 2013 is when I made her acquaintance on my programs. Just one of many people who, I better put this here so it didn't fall. Just one of many people who posted comments and said, well, I was doing a good job and they enjoyed what I did. And I appreciated that. She continued to post comments. And one time she sent me a private message on YouTube when they used to have private messages on there. And she told me a little bit about herself. She said, Ray, my name is Audra and I want to let you know. I won't tell you everything about this, but I'm just going to tell you that the gist of it is that she said that she has cancer. She has a problem with her blood, and she has a cancer. There's no cure for it. They're trying to treat it, but there's no cure for it. She wanted to make sure that I knew that when she's going through the pain in her life, that she turns to my channel to escape for just a very short time. And it's a world of green and happiness, and people are actually loving life. And that I put out such a love for life and for plants and pets and people that it recharges her. And she let me know this. And that was so incredibly special. So I made a program, and I have a link for it down below if you want to watch it. And it was my dedication to Audra. I made it the year of Audra. And I told her, I said, no. There will be no dying, and you're going to live for quite a long time, Audra. I promise you that. And I put out my best positive vibes or energy from then on, and I made sure that she knew that I was thinking of her whenever I put out that positive energy. So we became really good friends because of that. And one of her things was she said she needed, not she wanted to, she needed to live long enough so that her young daughter would be old enough to understand and to take care of herself. And so she was doing everything on heaven and earth to keep herself alive. She went through radiation, chemotherapy, you name it. She went through that procedure. And a lot of people may not agree with going through so much hell in order to keep yourself alive. And she was in pain constantly. She was in discomfort. She couldn't sleep. She couldn't focus. But she still came back and watched my programs and kept in touch with me. And I kept in touch with her. And it was 1 week after my birthday this year, she died. And she couldn't, it got to be a point where even though she wanted to stay alive, she knew that her time had come. Her daughter had grown since 2012. She was a strong, beautiful, healthy girl, and her husband was there to take care of his daughter. And she finally let go. And Audra died this year. But what was odd and truly special about Audra is on her deathbed in the hospice before she died, right before she died, she painted this for me. She was thinking of me. And she wanted to make sure that I knew that she was thinking of me. This was a present for me, and she wanted it sent to me. So I received this after she died, and it was a surprise and an honor. So Audra is a very special person. And you know, she was just one of many in the comments section behind that camera out in the internet. And when people tell me, they're just people on the internet, you know? Friendships aren't real on the internet. People on the other end, they're not, you know, it's not real. You can turn off your computer, it doesn't exist. They do exist. You exist. You know, you're a real person. And the connection that I make with these people, and see, the gifts are beautiful, regardless of monetary value. The fact that I am reaching people and people are reaching out to me, we connect over things that are happy, sad, profound, mundane, beautiful, ugly. It doesn't matter. The fact is that it's something. This is something that I have going on here with people all over the world, and I value that more than anything. So, you know, to answer your question, the things that I have received, the gifts, are absolutely beautiful, and every single one of them means everything to me. So that's the answer to your question. Audra, she's a beautiful person, and she's at peace now, and I'm okay with that. I'm very happy for her, and I'm happy for her daughter, and I'm happy for her husband, and I'm happy for having known her. I'm a better person for having known her, and I'm a better person for having known you. Yeah, you, every one of you. You're watching this. I know you. You know me, and I like that, and I'm going to continue to do this. Regardless of what happens, what you know, the bad things, the negative things, that's all nothing to me. You know, I deal with that. It just rolls off my back. It's the positive aspect of what I've gained and what I've given that keeps me going here. And I do appreciate it. I want to send a special thank you out to all of you, a personal thank you for all that you've done for me. I really do appreciate you. Okay, that wraps it up for Weekend Edition. Stay tuned next time. Next time, I'm going to head outside and we're going to do some stuff. I hope we're going to head outside again, if Mother Nature agrees. Thanks for joining me, everybody, and you have a great day. Bye.